This section is really just looking at the basics of plotting and today's tables. And we'll be also just looking at the use of Power BI. So the examples of where you might use the topics that we're going to look at now are, say your coworker comes to you and says, well, I've got this batch data, like we mentioned earlier, and at the end of the batch, you take a yield. So perhaps the yield of the substrate. You've got data going back 3 years, so 1,200 odd points. You'd like to know how you can better understand that data by summarizing it and also looking at any time-based trends. So we'll look at the time series plot for doing that. Or if you're working in life insurance, how do you understand the relationship between factors that affect the time the person will live, so the expected life expectancy related to other factors, so say background education. This happens all the time, right? When someone is writing out a life insurance policy, they're looking at the statistical factors. It's based on probabilities. They're looking at what factors will influence your time duration. And in fact, the government of Canada publishes what are known as life tables. That you can go look up and see at age 30, or whatever age might be, you're expected to live another 50 years. So they'll use these sorts of tools and factors like education and other information about you to make predictions. So how can we understand graphically those relationships? And the tool we'll use for that is, of course, a scatter plot. Or your boss comes and asks you, how can you summarize the improvement in a way that I can show other people? We're producing these aluminum slabs, and each slab has one or more defects, or hopefully none, but sometimes one or more defects. How can you summarize those defects on all 17 different grades? So each grade is just slightly different from the other. Maybe the chemistry of the aluminum is, or the impurities in the aluminum give it extra properties like additional strength, or if it's an aerospace aluminum used for planes and shuttles, or is it an aluminum used for this computer's cover? How would those grades differ, and the defects, of course, are different for different grades. How can you summarize that data? Or yourself, you might be interested in plotting out the data from a batch. So if you've got a batch producing methadone, you've got, as I gave an example similar to this earlier on, you've got 24 measurements taken against time. That's 300 minutes, 5 readings per minute. That's 36,000 data points. What are effective ways of summarizing that sort of data? Every class I'll begin with sort of these types of usage examples where it puts it in perspective where you can use these tools. But ultimately, by the end of this course, you'll have a collection of several tools that are appropriate in different situations. So I hope these examples help you figure out when to use the tools you learned from. The material in this section comes from a lot of the work by Edward Tufte. This is one of his books, Visual Display of Quantitative Information. There's a few others written by him. There's also books by William Cleveland in the library. And there's a paper for the grad students to go read after this course producing ChartJunk in Excel. So ChartJunk is a word coined by Edward Tufte for what a lot of software just produces, like all these default settings produced by the software. And this paper shows how Microsoft Excel produces a lot of ChartJunk that you have to deal with first before you actually start looking at your data. So grad students can read that. Now, admittedly, this class is easy stuff. Really, it's not something that is even part of the curriculum for this class. I added it in over December. I was working away on preparing the material. And this area of visualization is an area that I'm interested in. And I always appreciate if people email me interesting plots that they see in newspapers or websites that show data in interesting ways. So I do that kind of out of interest, and I thought, no, it's good for people that deal with data. In an engineering environment, it's all about data. Computer systems that are acquiring these huge amounts of data sets all the time. How can you effectively deal with it? I mean, we can teach tools like least squares and multivariate data analysis and principal components analysis to deal with large volumes of data, but another way that you can really get insight into your data is by plotting it well. So it seems easy, this topic. It's almost too obvious, some of the things I'm talking about. But that's because our brains and our eyes are so hardwired for graphical data now. We're always looking around, we're processing gigabytes of data every minute, just from our visual input. We're excellent at figuring out what is noise and what is signal, what is a pattern. For 2-3 years, I worked in multivariate image analysis, where I was writing computer programs that would, in real time, use cameras, like the one at the back of the class, and process the data coming from that, and try and do something that a human does. So something as simple as finding a black spot on a white background. And sometimes the black spot isn't black, it's a little bit gray. And then your algorithm fails, because I can write computer code very easily that will find something black and white. But the moment the sunlight goes down, and now the whole image becomes a little bit darker, that black spot and the contrast between black and white isn't quite the same as it was before, and your computer algorithm doesn't find the defect. But your human eye, without you even realizing it, you're compensating for changes in light, you're compensating for signal and noise, you're finding patterns all the time. I mean, from an evolutionary point of view, people say we're good at spotting lions in trees because we're used to running away from that sort of threat. So we're finding subtle patterns inside just what might visually look like noise very comfortably all the time. So when someone shows you a bad plot, you can still see what's going on in there. But the purpose of this class is to show how you can improve that and make it easier to really get your message across. So that's what we're focusing on. So if this does seem too easy and too obvious, it is because it really is. So we'll also hear this expression from time to time, let the data speak for themselves. I can count on several hands the number of clients that say that to me, let the data speak to you by itself. Well, no, if you just plot the data badly, it's not going to be able to do that. You have to look and learn how to do it well. And I by no means pretend that I do it well. You'll see coming up later in the course, some of the charts I produce don't follow these rules. It's because I'm just using the default settings from Excel or MATLAB, and they violate some of these concepts that we're talking about. But we don't always have time to go and fix up things and make them look as good as we'd like. In fact, I'll show you in this course some examples of charts that I've produced in the past that now, 2-3 years later, I come back and realize, ouch, that's really a bad way of looking at data. Is there a way to do that? Okay, so enough of the intro out of the way. Let's take a look at time series plots. So a time series plot is a 2D plot, but it's only showing one thing. It's one variable. We say it's univariate. So if it's a 2D plot, you're plotting time, usually on the x-axis, the horizontal axis. And it may not be time, it might just be sequence. Number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And on the y-axis, we're plotting the value of that univariate variable. So our eyes are good at, like I said, they're finding sinusoids, patterns, spikes, outliers, noise. Say you're plotting the temperature measurement of this room, and for whatever reason, the temperature sensor has a blip, just a spike. So instead of showing 21, 22 and fluctuations, suddenly there's a blip of 32 for one data point and then it comes back down. You'll say, it's probably a bad reading, someone disturbed the sensor or something like that. You just go on so good. We're very good at doing that. And time series plots are good ways to show that. But some things that are important for time series data are good labeling. So this I found it by accident, actually. I just grabbed it, from this website. I don't even know what that website's about. But this guy had the temperature of his CPU plotted up over time. And obviously, he's got just the default settings because this x-axis is very uninformed. So when we're dealing with time-based data, use an x-axis that means something, and it becomes particularly important when you start zooming in on the data. You need to use a good software tool that will recalibrate your x-axis for you as you zoom in and out. Automatically, you don't want to pause, right-click, change the axis settings, come back and analyze the data. You just interrupt yourself and delay. So using good software to do that is helpful. Also notice, we're picking up some sort of sinusoidal trend in the data. Even though he's drawn a green line, which is probably not that easy to see from the back, you can see that there's some sort of pattern. Here it seems to be spiking on a what might be a Wednesday or a Thursday, then it's moved back one day, then there's another spike over here. So there seems to be some sort of trend in the data. It doesn't match anything that means anything, but it's worth investigating perhaps. So we'll see that a lot. When you're working in industry, the first thing you do when there's a problem, you ask, look, something's off in the process, our production is not quite on target. You go to the computer systems and you do a query and you look at the data for the past month, say. And you just plot it up in time series order. And mentally, you're asking questions. Do I see any patterns? Are there any anomalies? Are there any spikes? So your brain is doing all of that without you even realizing. But what we need is a good x-axis to put it in context for us. When it comes to multiple data, multiple trajectories, so we don't just deal with one variable, now we're looking at three or four or five, well then people start doing things like this where you use different colors, which may not be a good idea if you're colorblind, and it's more common than you think for people to be colorblind. There's a large percentage of people that really are. So colors or different color markers or different dashes and dots or lines. But does anyone notice the pattern in that data over there, in the first row? Is there anything you notice between the three variables?
I can see some pattern between the green and the blue.
Yeah.
They are moving together up and down.
Okay,
and
the
other one.
So you picked it up, even though it's a very poor plot, you picked out exactly what's going on there. And I'd say it's probably far more effective to show it something like that, where you see that pattern almost right away. You can see then A, B, and C moving in that correlated way. Variable A and B moving together, up and down together, and then variable C, what will, at least of course said inverse over here, we'll quantify that and call it negatively correlated. So variable C is negatively correlated with B, and A and B are positively correlated with each other. We'll introduce that terminology in the next part. But these non-default settings take a little while to do. I was using Apple's numbers software package to do this, and I've never used it before, so it took me about 10 minutes to kind of fine-tune the settings. But the point with this is that good software will get it to you in the right format. R is very good at just putting the right details on the plots without you having to go tweak it afterwards. It's excellent for that. That's another reason why I prefer using R for these sorts of things. But also just to show you how good our eye is at picking up detail, is this plot, which is exactly the same as before, just compressed. So you can see A and B still moving together and variable C moving negatively or in the opposite direction to A and B. And this sort of plot shows exactly the same information as the previous one, and it's now, you see it a lot actually on financial websites, is where it's becoming really apparent. Google and Yahoo use it a lot to show finance data for the stock market indicators, because what you'll notice if you say you look at the financial stocks, or you look at the technology stocks, or the cyclical consumer goods stocks, you'll see all of them do exactly that together. The moment you start putting 20 of these one below the other, you put them in an array of 4x5, you really start to see all these stocks doing the same sort of thing. Or if you're investing in mutual funds, you'll see out of a group of 20 mutual funds, 3/4 of them follow the same patterns. All these investment mutual fund advisors are doing exactly the same thing. They're all buying and selling the same sorts of stocks at the same time. So we can see this huge data in a very small space. And this is also starting to become important for people who walk around in cars with these little tablet computers or iPods, where the data is being streamed to these tablet devices in real time. You can still show in that small space what was shown here. These 44, I think it was 44 data points were used, stretched out. You can still get a good idea of what's going on in that small space. So the human eye, the number I think I printed in the notes there, can pick out about 250 data points per linear inch and 650 data points per square inch. We can pick out very, very high levels of resolution in small spaces. So it's one way to make use of these things. This device of showing data like that is called the SparkLine. You've also probably seen it on hospital screens to display heart rate monitors or ECG, electro, I don't know what ECG stands for now. But where they join up 10, 12 different leads onto your body and they're measuring electrical signals. All those data moving down, up and down together, and they're monitoring and looking for anomalies. So say we plotted five or six of these plots together, and you see four of them moving in the same way, and then the fifth one is moving in a different way, but you know that all five should be moving in the same way. It's a very quick graphical way to find something that's not quite right. So if you, on your distillation column at Petro-Canada, and you've got your 20 temperature sensors, because these columns easily have 20 or more sensors wired up to them, and you plot just the temperature data, you're expecting the temperature of the column to move up and down together. So as you process a new raw material, or as the control systems kick in, all the temperature profiles and all the traits move up and down in the same way. But if you notice one of them moving in an unexpected way, on a table form of printed numbers, you won't see it. On a time series form, you won't see it very easily. But in this compact way, you can quickly spot anomalies occurring. So the point I'd like you to remember from this is when plotting multiple data, avoid doing this sort of thing on superimposing and using lots of colors and markers. Rather, spread it out into separate axes that are parallel to each other. Okay, just another thing. Sometimes I see this where people plot time-based data and then sort of towards the end of the time series, they want to zoom in on a certain piece and show you. So they've plotted data from 2005 to 2000, and end of 2009, but they want to zoom in and show you data just on 2009, so they put this magnifying glass in and blow up the region, or they'll suddenly stretch out the x-axis and that last bit. But the reason why you should not do that is because you've distorted any trends. Any sort of up and down trends that you may have started to see from the earlier data, now you have to readjust and recalibrate your eye and say, okay, well, this axis is now stretched, so a slope that's going up is really actually going up much steeper than it looks on paper. So avoid doing those tricks. Fortunately, software packages don't do that by default. It's usually you'll see this in newspapers and magazines, where they're trying to sometimes lie to you inadvertently by making the data appear worse than it is. Another place where that's used a lot, where people lie using statistics and data plots, are with time-based values. So if you plot in say your sales to DuPont, you're selling DuPont a raw material, and you want to look at the last 10 years of data, well, you should take into account the time value of money. Like the recession last year is a classic case of where everything is going to dip down in a time-based trend for that period of time. But if you factor in the inflationary effects or the time value of money effects, you can undo that. So this example here, let's see if I can get it up. Is from that website that's printed over there. It's plotting the retail sales of from a car dealer or from all the car dealerships in the United States since the 1970s. And so you can see people are just buying more and more cars, the sales are increasing over time. And you see the cyclical nature within the year. So this is New Year, and then it goes over to Christmas by the end and repeats. What else? It's really, you're just seeing, other than the upward trend, you're seeing maybe a flattish period in the 80s recession over there. But when you adjust it for time, for the cost of living expense, then you're really getting a true picture. You see that that recession in the 80s actually lasted quite a bit longer than the earlier part in 5. And you see that there was actually this dip in the mid-70s as well, and then the mid-90s. Whereas the earlier plot just kind of shows things are going up and up and up. But the reality on a time value of money basis is different. The other thing that's often done to distort the truth is you show a selected period of the data. So this is a stock shown only between January 91 and March 91. And that's a fantastic rate of return. I'd love to invest in stocks that go up 60% in 3 months. But then if you look at the bigger picture around it, it's still good, but it's really not that the change isn't that much over the period of a year and a half. And if you go back further still, you're starting to see, well, that was really a very unusual spike for whatever reason. And then if you look at all the data from 85 to 2009, you're seeing that, well, that's really just that little blip back in there. So whenever you get the sinking feeling, well, we're not quite seeing everything here, or you're wondering, well, is this really the whole truth? Ask for more data, zoom out, and get full context. Because, like I said earlier, we're very good at picking up signal from noise. You wouldn't even notice that blip in there if you had more context. And by the way, this is Apple stock. So if you bought it here, the beginning of last year, we would double the money. Bar plots. So, again, a univariate plot, one variable only, and it's on a 2D axis. But we don't call it X and Y axis this time because bar plots are very easily flipped around. Actually, sometimes they look better with the bars horizontally and vertically. So we can't really call it X and Y, we call it the category axis and the value axis. And so here I've shown a fictitious example for someone's budget breakdown, where they spend money on their house, their car, investments, groceries, and so on. Notice it's easy to order these things in a different way. I mean, most software will just order it for you alphabetically. You'll have car at the top and you'll have travel at the bottom. And then the bars will just kind of be a jumble. But it makes more sense, and you kind of get some extra interpretation from the bar plot by reshuffling the axis according to some other criteria. In this case, I'm not really reshuffled by another criteria, I've just shuffled it by the actual value on the y-axis. But in some cases, coming back to a chemical plant example, say you're looking at number of failures on different units, say pumps. Pumps are everywhere in the process. They're at the beginning, the middle, the end of your process. Say you're plotting pump failures per region in the plant. Then it makes sense that you do not order your numbers just by the pump number. So you'll have pump 101, pump 102, pump 103, because those pumps are not necessarily in physical order. But if you order the plot from top to bottom in the same order that the process goes through the flow sheet, then that may make more sense. But that's the whole point of a bar plot, is that the order in which you show the information doesn't really matter. If I shuffle this data around, you can still see that house expenses are the largest expense, and that insurance is the smallest expense, even if I reordered those rows. And that's the whole point of a category plot, is that there is no order to the rows, or to the bar plot, right? The category plot or the category axis can be arbitrarily reshuffled. Sometimes some sort of ordering does make more sense. Notice that it's a little bit different from a histogram, right? The histogram relies on the ordering. A histogram, like a probability histogram, you need that sort of left to right ordering to be consistent. But a bar plot is different in the sense that you can reshuffle the order and still get the same interpretation. However, if what you're plotting is time information, then you really question what you're doing. Right? If you're just plotting time information on the bar plot, reconsider using the line or the time series topic we started off with earlier. For a number of reasons. Firstly, bar plots always begin at zero. They have to begin at zero. Why? Because what you're getting from a bar plot is the area of the bar. So if you start this at a non-zero number, then the area is not proportional to the number you're trying to show. You have to start your category axis at zero. Sorry, your value axis at zero. But in this data, you see, for example, the smallest number is 63. There's no sense in having all this wasted space from 60 down. Right? You can really tighten up that axis and start from the lowest number. So that's one reason why to use a time series plot rather. The other is it's easier to see the trends in a time series plot. Remember we showed earlier, sinusoids and spikes and so on are much easier to spot in a time series plot. You can see the rate of change more easily in the slope than on a bar plot. You still get it from a bar plot, but it's easier in a time series plot. So the moment you start plotting time-based data and you're using a bar plot, consider your options. That maybe a time series plot would be better. Just a comment on that. Like, you'll often see that in newspapers and financial reports. They'll show data like this, quarter one, it's plot, and quarter two, and they'll show it as bars. But really, a time series plot works much better. Maybe they don't do it because they're afraid of what the true meaning of the data is. This is more of just a side of issue. It's really not that important. But one thing to point out is how redundant a bar plot is. Right? So there's this principle in good graphics that you use your ink to only show the data. You don't use your ink to embellish or add unnecessary things to a plot. So if we're following that principle, a bar plot is actually extremely inefficient. Imagine for a moment that I take away everything on this bar except I leave the black line that goes from 0 up to 85. So I take away the gray shading, I take away all this other black edges, the top line, and take away the number 85. And all you're left with is a group of sticks pointing straight up and ending at the point where you should. You can still have exactly the same trends with that. Right? So the left edge is showing you the 85, the right edge is showing you the 85. So that's the first 2 points. The bar's surface area, colored in here in gray, is showing you that it's proportional to 85. So you're getting 85 in 6 different ways. The other way you're getting it is the number's position, where it's written, up and down. The top edge of each bar, so this black line over here. So if you just had a whole lot of little sticks going up and down, you'd still get the same information. And then the number itself. You could just write this in a table, actually, and still get the same interpretation. So bar plots are inefficient from that point of view. So we'll call this principle the concept of maximizing your data ink. So data ink is the ink shown that's related just to the data that you're actually plotting, just to the quantity. And the total ink for graphics is, of course, all the other pixels that you plot that are there. So if we're trying to maximize data ink, what that means is you should minimize ink that's not related to the data. So any superfluous stuff, just leave off. We'll consider just using a table. So for small amounts of data, bar plots are unnecessary. Here I'm showing the profit for a fictitious company by a region in Canada. And the table does exactly what the bar plot's doing. Actually, in the data sense. Another thing is this plot can make, when you start adding these strange vibrations and hatchings and stuff, the plot it just detracts from the message you're trying to pass on. So avoid those. And I said earlier, use horizontal bars, especially when the label is so long that you can't fit it in. Try to avoid making your reader have to bend their head to read your plot. So just rotate the plot 90 degrees forward and then make the plot horizontal. you guys want a 10-minute break now? I think it's pretty, we've gone through a lot. So, or do you want to just do the next section? How do you feel?
Did we just end earlier?
Just had a break? Yeah, so let's go to the next section and we'll have a break after that. So box plots, another univariate plot. So we've looked at two univariate plots, time series and bar plots. But a box plot shows you a summary of one variable. But it's a little bit different this time because box plots actually allow you to compare between univariate variables. I'll show that in a second. So the five-number summary is just you probably covered this in an earlier stats course, but the five-number summary for a univariate variable is the minimum on the one extreme, and then you've got the three percentiles, 25th, 50th, and 75th percentile. And all that means, just as a recap, the 25th percentile is if you took all your data that you're wanting to plot, and you sorted it from smallest to large, and the 25th percentile is the number sorted, like, so you go from the smallest to largest number, and where the 25% of the data falls below, that's your 25th percentile. The 50th percentile is take your data, sort it, and find the point where to the left 50% of your data y and to the right 50% of your data y. So that's just the median. The median is defined as sorting the data and picking the middle number up. And then the third quartile, the 73rd percentile, is the same thing. That's the point below the 75% of the data. Now, what we do then is we compute those five numbers from the data, and then we just display it. So in your notes, I've got this display. Just to put this in context, what's going on here is this is data from a process up in Quebec where they take trees and so you've got a tree and they have a machine called the debarker that distributes the outside layer of bark. So you've debarked it and then you're left with just the wood. Then it goes through a device that takes the top and the bottom off. And before it does that, the tree actually passes through a set of laser scanners and it computes the optimal way to cut the tree. So it computes that from this tree I can get three 2x4s and a 2x6. So if I get a 2x6 out here in the center, and I will get a couple of 2x4s out the sides here. And maybe something smaller in the edge. So it will go and it finds the optimal way to cut that. So once it's gone through that device, then you've got an object that looks like this. And then it goes through another set of laser scanners, and within, what's it now, there's about 10 logs that go through the spin per second. So it's incredibly fast that it's calculating the optimal cut. It recomputes, okay, maybe because of this cut wasn't quite where the first scanner projected, it re-optimizes and determines the optimal cuts. Okay? Then after it goes through that device, you've got your rough 2x6 or 2x4. So the data that's over here is the thickness measurements after one of these boards is cut. Then they go one by one through yet another laser scanner, and it measures on the board six thickness values at those six locations. And the 2x6 isn't actually 2 inches thick. It's one and a half. And so that's what these numbers represent. They represent in 1/1000th of an inch, the thickness determined by the laser scanner. So we've got those six numbers for 100 boards, shown here as a box plot on the next slide. But before I get to that, in R, once you've loaded the data up, you just type this command, summary boards, and it will show you a printed summary. So it shows you the minimum, the first quartile, the median, and the mean. So you're getting two estimates of this, of the middle there, and then the third quartile and the maximum. So for those 100 boards at position 1, over here, you're getting that summary. And the box plot is showing that to you in a graphical way. Right? So just to break it down, what's going on in the box plot, I presume you covered this in the prior course, right? What each of those mean. But just to recap, so you've got your box, and that horizontal bar is your median. This upper edge over here is your 25th percentile, and that's your 75th percentile, and that's your 50th percentile. Okay, and then this distance is called the IQR, the interquartile range, because it's going from one quartile to the other. So that distance between quartile 1 and 3, or percentile 25 and 75, is a measure of the spread around the median. So we can see here quickly which of the six positions on the board have larger and smaller spreads. So that's the nice thing about a box plot, is even though it's univariate, one variable at a time, as long as you've got the same sort of data, you can plot them next to each other and get a quick comparison. So if, say, coming back to that distillation example of Petro-Canada, you take the box plot and put it off the 20 temperature sensors on the distillation column, you can get a quick summary for the degree of means, or the averages, as well as the spreads for those 20 temperatures. So box plots are good to compare similar data that's on the same scale in the same units of measurement. So here position 5 is tighter than, say, position 3. And why is position 3 so variable, so much more variable than, say, position 5? Well, it comes from the fact that where sensor 3 is recorded. Here's sensor 3 over there, which is always on the edge of the board. And if we look back at how that board was cut, so if it was cut over there, say that the saws didn't quite get at the spot, maybe that board was actually shifted over a little bit over here, then the thickness at that edge, at point position 3, is sometimes going to be what the computer predicted it was going to be. But if the saws were just off a few mils, then that position 3 and position 6 have larger variance than the other positions. So you can quickly see that from this sort of plot. The other things about the box plot are what's called the hinges. These points over here. So we'll extend a dashed line and then draw a horizontal, and we'll do that in the same bottom. So that hinge, the upper hinge, is we take the median and we go up 1.5 interquartiles. We'll go from the median and we'll go down 1.5 interquartiles. You don't have to do 1.5, that's typically what's done. So go up and down 1.5 IQR units and up from the median, and that's where the hinge falls. Then any points that happen to be in your sample beyond the upper and lower hinges are shown as dots. And we might consider those outliers. Those are points that are, well, let's take a look at this. We're running a bit out of space here, but this distance over here is obviously three IQR units, three interquartile ranges. So it's almost like the concept of mean and standard deviation. The interquartile range is a measure of spread. So it's almost like it's three standard deviations, 1.5 on either side of the median. So those points are pretty far out on the distribution if you plot it as a probability plot. So they show up there. So here's an extreme outline at position 4. And then we can see also at saw position 2 and 5, we have a whole bunch of outliers. So it's just a nice way to show anything beyond the normal. Just some other points. Sometimes people use the mean instead of median. You don't have to show outliers. Sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. 1.5 IQR is an option you can set in the software. To plot the hinge. And then sometimes people set, instead of plotting the hinge at 1.5 IQR up or 1.5 IQR down, they sometimes set that at the second or the 98th percentile. But those are just some variations that you see. Generally, in R, the defaults are what I described earlier. 1.5 IQRs up and down, and it shows the median. One thing that was interesting is that for position 1 on the board, you see there that the box plot, how the median is skewed off to one side. Well, the interpretation of that is if you have to plot this histogram, I'll just draw the histogram here on the side, is that the histogram's median is over here. So I'm going to draw the histogram sideways here. The median is there. There's the 25th percentile, there's the 75th percentile. So as a histogram, that has to look something like that. So it's showing the fact that that median isn't in the center of the box. Let's just draw it this way. It's showing that it's peaking, and then it's got a long tail. So the 75th percentile is here, and the 25th percentile is here. That's why your box is. So there's the median, the 75th percentile. So the distribution, you get some sort of impression about what that distribution is looking like. We'll say that this distribution is skewed to the right, because it's got more of a heavier tail towards the right edge. So that's another thing you get from the box plot. With the lines in the center, you know the distribution is more symmetrical. So a scatter plot is now all the plots we looked at prior to this are univariate. The scatter plot is a bivariate plot. It's on a 2D axis, and on each axis you put the lower and upper levels, and it's a collection of points in those axes, and each point is at the intersection of the two values of each axis. And really, what it's asking you to do, it's an unspoken intention of the scatter plot, it's asking you to draw a cause and effect relationship. You're looking at the relationship of how one variable moves with the other. It's not saying necessarily there is a cause and effect relationship, but it's kind of implying that to some extent. So this is actual data from the distillation column, where the vapor pressure is measured at the bottoms of the distillation column, and the temperature is at the top of the tower. So I'll just extend it on there. So off at the bottom, also the reboiler, is where we measure the vapor pressure, VP. And this temperature is at the top of the tower. So we're measuring the temperature over here and the vapor pressure there. They're negatively correlated, because we know that from the Hamilton equation, that's from the physical first principle. So this is actually cause and effect. As the temperature increases, the vapor pressure from this petroleum product decreases. We know this, and in fact this is what's used to control the vapor pressure. The vapor pressure is the quantity that determines the quality coming off the bottoms. That's what they sell this product based on, is based on the vapor pressure. So if they want to control it and keep it to a certain target, they manipulate the tower's temperature. So there is a known cause and effect relationship here. On the other hand, something silly like this, you see tons of these examples everywhere in statistics books to show the fallacy of cause and effect. Well, here I'm plotting, this is based on an example Dr. Marlin told me about, where he heard on the radio, they were talking about how the number of gray hairs or white hairs on a person's head was related to osteoporosis. Well, it's not cause and effect. Because as you get older, your bones become less dense, but you also get more gray hair. So there's some other variable that's causing it, but you're just seeing the two effects. We're not saying white hair, if I had less white hair on my head, I'd have a higher bone mineral density. Well, I could just go dye my hair if I had osteoporosis, right? You wouldn't suddenly have low osteoporosis then by dyeing your hair. So that's not cause and effect. You see this nonsense all the time. The classical plot of this is where they plot number of births against the number of stalks. We know that stalks don't deliver babies, so there's no cause and effect relationship. Or they show alcohol consumption against Baptist ministers. And so silly things like that come up all the time. There's other variables that are the cause. You're just seeing the effects. So even though a scatter plot is asking you to draw some sort of cause and effect relationship, just look out for it. That may not really be the cause that you're seeing on those two plots. We'll have a discussion about cause and effect later on in the course as well. So just some points about scatter plots. Tighten those axes in as tight as you can. The defaults on some of the software, again, you see this often is that you're plotting a scatter plot and the data are kind of up here. Because for some reason, Excel does this. It tightens up the x-axis to be from the lowest to the highest value. But then it often starts the y-axis at 0. Maybe your first measurement's at 200. So you've got all this wasted white space here. So just a simple rule to tighten those up. Avoid lots of grid lines because you can't then see the data for the grid lines. And that applies to the amount of ink you use. Now, just another point regarding these scatter plots is I find it strange that we don't use more of them. Right? They're tremendously useful to show, and I'll show you by the end of this section, you can show up to 5 dimensions on a 2D scatter plot. You can show 5 different variables on a 2D scatter plot. Not on paper, but on a computer screen. On paper, you can show 4 dimensions. Now, the thing is, you don't see them in plots. And if you go into any chemical plant, I'll challenge you to tell me how many scatter plots you can count on the screens of the operators. Because it's not that they're stupid, but I've worked with operators who've had high school education, and I've shown them scatter plots. And after being with them for a day, working on them with them in the plant, by the end of that day, they know the top left corner has such and such behavior, the bottom right corner has such and such behavior. They can figure it out. It's not that they're silly. Often what happens is the engineers who design these charts for the operators assume that they're stupid. Well, it's not that the engineers are necessarily assuming they're stupid. It's that we see this all the time. Tufte here did a study where he took samples from newspapers from between 74 and 80 from various countries around the world. So Europe, Japan, Asia, and North America. And showed that no scatter plots exist in North American newspapers. So the study is somewhere here. He's used New York Times, the Times from Britain, Washington Post, and some German papers in the Wall Street Journal. 0%, 0%, 0%, 0%, over a 6-year period of random samples. The Red Flag, which is a Japanese journal, 30,000, has 9% scatter plots, and other Japanese papers have. The Economist from Britain has as well. So it's not that people can't understand it. Another study he cites it shows that 12-year-olds get it. You see it in math classes in high school. So we do get scatter plots. So people assume the operators won't know how to do it. And I know for a fact that they can. I've seen them and I've worked with operators. They can get it. So it's a far more effective way to show data sometimes. So don't assume that the audience cannot understand. If you design the graph and you can interpret it, your audience can as well. Just some other things you can add to your scatter plots. You can add box plots to the side, or you can add histograms to the side. I think that gives a little bit of extra context regarding the density of the data. And here's where you can add 4 dimensions. Okay, so it's not so helpful in your printout, but on here and on this website that's linked on the course website, we're plotting 4 variables. The x-axis is, this is all data from the United Nations, so this is income per person, or GDP per capita, and it's adjusted for inflation, so we can compare countries that are have different currencies to each other fairly. So we've adjusted for inflation, we've adjusted on a per person basis, GDP per capita. So we're plotting that on a log scale, so 40,000 over here, and I believe Canada is one of these walls over here. That's the United States over there, and that's China. On the y-axis, we're plotting children per woman. So the number of children rank in China, it's just below 2. In Canada, it's below 2. In the US, it's just above 2. In these other countries, it's up as high as 5, 6, and 7. So those are the two X and Y variables. The size of the data, the size of each circle, represents the third dimension, that's the population. So it's not so clear, but at the bottom, this half circle here shows you that diameter is 1.46 billion people. I believe it corresponds to China. So that the width of that ball is 1.46 million, then everything else is ratioed down to that. And then in color, we're showing life expectancy of a baby in 2007. This data is, as you can see in the background, is all from 2007. Life expectancy from a baby born in that year. So as high as 80 years in red and as low as, well, I don't think there's any countries where it's 20 years, but there's some pretty low countries, 35 and 40. And then, so you can see some nice trends. Well, not only do you see, and I'm not saying this is cause and effect, because it definitely isn't. GDP does not cause women to have less children. So richer countries, it's a side effect of richer countries that women have less children. So again, there's that whole cause and effect thing going on. But you can see some interesting patterns in the color trend. So there's a general trend down in color from your life expectancy. Here's an interesting one. I think this is Indonesia over here that's kind of out of sequence. Everything else seems to be going from reds to orange to yellows to greens. Indonesia is a little bit out of sync. So there's four dimensions. And then you can get the fifth dimension of time if you move those plots. So so going back to 1882, you can play this data and see how the countries change. So you'll see China dropping down. As the countries get richer, they move down. And fertility drops. You see how China just suddenly moved down? Now they're moving across and down. So you can have some fun with this this website. And they have tons of variables. You can change the x-axis and the y-axis. So you can look at births, deaths, disasters, economy, education. They even have teeth. So the number of bad teeth per child. So you can plot all those interesting things. Not that it's all cause and effect. Just bear in mind, this is not my area. I don't know why what causes women to have fewer children as countries become richer. But it's definitely a correlation that's very strong.
How do you know what country each
hole corresponds to? Oh, yeah, that's an interesting, they've done it really nicely. You can hold your mouse over to it. So you see that China's up there. Then if you, okay, so now that you know China's that ball over there, then when you play it, you can see how it actually increased for a period, decreased, see how sharply it drops down in the 80s, in the 70s, 80s, when they instituted their one-child policy. And then it moves across as China's become wealthy. So I give a link actually to a video on the course website. There's a 20-minute link of the guy who's responsible for the search charting. And he goes much more in depth into the whys of these patterns. And his thesis is that really the poorer countries are not, we often think the poor countries are in Africa, or that's where all the problems are. Well, he shows, uses this data to show that that's not necessarily the case. From a purely statistical point of view, this is showing five dimensions. And as our lives become more and more electronic with e-book readers and tablet computers, we're moving from four dimensions now to a fifth dimension. Maybe when we start getting holographic computers, we can get a sixth dimension, but maybe not in my lifetime. Let's take a look now at, so that's scatter plots. Let's take a look at table. The purpose of a table is to compare. Right? So we're comparing categories. So usually we'll put the things we want to compare and go across the columns. So the first column will be, say, in this case, I want to buy a new car, and I'm considering, should I buy or should I lease? So the first column, I'll put the monthly payments if I buy, and the second column, I'll put the monthly payments if I lease. So the things you want to compare with each other, you usually put from between column left to right. The things you want to compare them on, you put in the rows. So I'm comparing different cars. So that's one example. There's another example in the notes and shown here as well, where I mentioned there about the different defects. So let's take a look here. This company is producing several products. They're all different types of metal, say. And they've got different codes for each grade. So grade 4636, grade 2524, and so on. And they're plotted here by total number of defects. I've ordered them by total number of defects. Again, rather than just ordering them alphabetically, you can order your data. So, you know, I said this as well in the categorical plot, in the bar plot. You can order your category by some other third piece of information and make the table more interesting, rather than just by default sorting it alphabetically. So, like back at the car payments example, here it happens to be sorted alphabetically by Ford, Honda, Mazda, Toyota, BMW, but I could have reordered it rather by the insurance payment, monthly insurance payment. That, even though I'm not comparing the insurance payment, I'm interested in the first two columns. But I could have reordered the tables in row order so that it's by insurance payment. That way I'm getting a bit of a sense of not only the comparison between the monthly payment for buying versus leasing, but I'm also getting the insurance payment ranking. Now, if I just look at this table as it is now, I have to mentally go sort through that and see, okay, well, the Yaris is lower payments than the other one. But if the tables was automatically sorted, it's not a problem. This is not too much of an issue because we deal with data on paper. But now, almost any good software package will put a little hyperlink here at the top, allowing you to click and change the sort order from smallest to maximum. You can change that arbitrarily. So if you're doing this electronically, it's not a big deal. But in printed form, try to give your user some other third dimension for free by just reordering the row. Okay, back to the defects concept here. I'm plotting, as I said, different grades in a row. So that's the thing we want to compare between. Those are our categories. But the things we're really trying to compare are columns A to B. Which defects are more or less? Well, here we see for this grade, there's fewer defects for that grade than for defect type B. So we're comparing column by column. But again, it depends on the question we're asking. If we're interested in comparing within a grade, so within a grade or within a row, then it makes sense to present the data this way. But if we're interested in comparing grade to grade to grade to grade, then we're actually going down the row. So the way you read the table is dependent on the question you're asking of the data. It seems obvious, just to point it out. Also, it may be useful to redraw that table in the form of production rate. The reason why I point that out is, say for example, grade 4636. So if you've got the table there in front of you, so I don't need to flip back and forth to the screen. Look at row 4636, the first row on the table. There's, I believe, 37 defects for type A. Right? But, and then the last row is grade 2610. And there's only 5 defects of type A. So you may think, okay, if your boss said, you've got a budget of $10,000 this year, use it in the best way to reduce defects, like buy new equipment, install control systems, or whatever, to reduce defects. Which defect would you target? Well, you might say, okay, I'll target defects for grade 4636. I know that when grade 4636 runs, it's got such and such a properties that cause the defect. So I'm going to try and deal with just that defect. But what you have to really see is taken in context of production rate. Maybe you produce maybe you produce a lot of grade 4636. That's why you've got more defects. Or grade 2610 is produced at a much lower rate. That's why there's only 5 defects. So again, redraw this data table, perhaps on a production rate basis, on a fractional basis. And then you can get a true picture. So tables are useful. Like if I just show this to you in graphical form, you couldn't go back and do anything with the data. But if I give it to you in table form, you can make sense of it, but you can then take those numbers and do something more. So I often say tables are still pretty good People don't like to look at tables. They say, I don't understand the table of numbers. Sure, it is a little harder, but you can do a little bit more with the data table. Okay, just some other things to avoid is if you're showing breakdowns, like that defects example is a classic example. You've got 137 defects, and I want to show defect A occurs 15%, defect B occurs 35%, defect C occurs 70%. Throw up a pie chart. Yay, because it shows fractions. We all learn in high school or primary school even that a pie chart is a nice way to learn fractions. Well, there's really, it's not a good way to show data at all. This is a graph I drew. It's on a website that I run and I'm responsible for that shows where students from the MACC group go on to work after graduate studies. So once they've finished, X percent of work in ecology supply plant operations and broken down by region, most stay in Canada, some go on to the United States. So I did this a year or so ago. And then I was reading up about pie charts and I realized, oops, this probably should be a data table, not a pie chart. Why? Well, if I asked you how many students from MACC go on and stay in the academic profession, what would you say? Numbers?
Roughly 7 or 8%.
Okay, and in small consulting?
12, I don't know,
12, 13, 18. It's hard. Our eyes are just not made to read angles. The human eye can read linear things very, very easily. You can pick up micrometers of difference. If someone hangs a painting skew on the wall, you can see within millimeters that it's off. But angles, our eyes are just not made for angles. I want to know that information. 18% for academic and 20% for small consulting, whatever. So what do? You go add the percentages onto the pie chart. Then what do you end up with? You end up with the data table. You've got the numbers and the labels on a pie chart. What's the point? Put it in a data table. It's just easier. So there's several other reasons for not using pie charts. That I've given a hyperlink there to a guy who's written up a 10-page so little write-up about pie charts and why they're pretty bad. Almost there's no good reason ever to use a pie chart. He mentions one very minor case, like that you almost never have to do it, that a pie chart might be okay. But there's almost never a good usage for pie charts. Some other things just about tables, quickly. I mentioned this about reordering the rows, maybe as by some other third variable. And then the use of excessive grid lines. It's interesting to point out that this example here has low vertical grid lines. But the human eye is again very good at picking out the white space and imputes vertical grid lines there. Your eye mentally just knows that that's a separate column. You don't need to have an actual line. So sometimes this is a reasonable example. Sometimes I've seen cases where the black lines are just so thick that you can't see the data through this big grid. Okay, and then just to end off the section on tables, is this a neat example. I thought this was really cool, going to show data. Here is fictitious data again for six different products. So K1C5 and K1P6 and so on down the road. And we're trying out new coatings. So this is a steel product, and the supplier provides us coating A and coating B. And we go and run on our six different products that we produce. We go try out coating A and coating B. So for corrosion resistance, that's the first two columns. And then surface roughness is the last two columns. And for corrosion resistance, a lower number is better. Does coating B improve corrosion resistance for all grades, and by how much? If you take a look at those numbers, so corrosion resistance has dropped as we go from A to B for pretty much, what are you mentally doing as you're scanning that data table, right? You're comparing, remember we said tables are for comparing, so you're comparing column A to B, just for corrosion resistance for now. But what are you mentally doing when you're comparing things? like mentally you're forming deltas, right? You're going 0.3 minus 0.22, okay, 0.08. 0.45 minus 0.39, that's a drop of 0.06. But you can't keep those deltas mentally accumulating in your head. Right? I could add a third column and show you the deltas, and you can see, okay, yeah, all these are negative numbers. They're dropping as we're going. The deltas are all negative, we're all going down. But it's far nicer to show that data this way. So here we're showing that exactly the same data. We're showing on this horizontal axis over here, vertical axis. The same data, so 0.22 is our lowest number and 0.76 is the highest. And then on this side, we're showing coating B. And the slopes show you not only the delta, but you're also seeing by how much. You can also then pick out quickly that grade P, the P series of products is not dropping, it's going up a little bit. But maybe that's within the range of statistical norms, who knows. But the interesting thing is showing that for corrosion resistance, you can see it does cause a significant drop for two out of the three product grades. But for surface roughness, the numbers seem to be all over the place. Whereas if you look at it at the table form, it's very hard to pick that out. Right? So sometimes, just a different way of thinking about your data can lead to a nice plot. And then you can take that to a third treatment. So say there was coating C, you could then add a new set of slopes across C and D and E and so on. So just different ways to think about the data. I won't cover this in any detail. This is all I had to say on data frames. Data frames are basically the axes that hold your data. Just tighten them up as much as possible, except when you're showing comparison plots. So if you're comparing different things, make sure that the axes are always the same. Like if you're comparing product A and product B, and you're showing the yields, and you've got a histogram of yields, make sure that you're comparing the two axes the same way. There's an example in the exercise we're doing where that is an issue. Then, just lastly about color, just remember that some of your readers are colorblind, and there's an estimate that up to 10% of people really can't distinguish all the colors quite as well as you might expect. So that is a problem when using color, and really, a lot of the stuff we consume, like you've got the notes this day, is in grayscale, so that we use the color. The other issue with color is it's common to see that blues and greens represent small values, and oranges and reds are high values, and then every other color in between. But really, there's no standard. That's just one way of presenting. I've seen it where there's different sequences of colors, so there's not one standard either. So whenever you use color, you have to have another legend that shows the usage. The safest way to present color is to use grayscale, to go from black to white. Everyone knows that black is always at the lowest end, white's always at the highest end. It looks good on prints, and it looks good for colorblind people as well. So, okay, just to wrap up on this section on plotting. If you're implying cause and effect, use a plot that has cause and effect. So use a scatter plot. If you want to compare things, use plots like bar plots or time series plots, and use the same axis to compare those things. Also, just remember that a plot should be like a paragraph of text. That's always how I like to see it, is put labels on your graph to highlight, outline other interesting points. It kind of has to tell a story. Avoiding codes and stuff is also helpful. Then, this is also an interesting thing. There's this expression that says if the statistics are boring, and you've got the wrong numbers. Because what you'll often see is people go and embellish their graph with pictures and unnecessary junk to try and cover up sometimes, or sometimes there really isn't any substance to this graph. Really all that's going on in this graph is that information. You can show that in a different way, more effectively. You don't need this whole picture to go with it. So there's plenty of examples where people go and try and make the graph exciting in some unnecessary way. Okay. Yep. So that's all I have to say about the visualization session. Before, there's just a little bit more that I want to show before I end the class. But just before doing that, are there any questions on this topic? It's not too difficult stuff. It's really, to me, this was just kind of like a warm-up class to get everyone thinking in the same way. And we'll really get into the meat of this course in the next few classes. But are there any questions so far? Okay. Okay, so these are the topics for next week's class. I'll be talking about variability and what it means, and we'll review probability and then go into the distributions. Now, was there, given that you this course has the prerequisite of the prior statistics class, are there any people, are there any topics from basic statistics and probability that you really didn't get the first time that you would think would be helpful for you to spend time on in the next class? Or is it covered by this topic? Like, I just want to make sure that everyone is up to speed in terms of the confidence of your background. Was there something that was like an open gap that you never quite got that might be interesting for the rest of the class to also revise? You don't have to shout it out now, but like, given that these are the topics, you can just send me an email and say, you know, it would be great if you could review the text, and I can work it into the notes. Okay, then just the final section is on the software. So I'm not going to demo the software here. I really just didn't have a chance over the holidays to prepare. I was preparing a lot of the notes and other things, but I wanted to prepare, and I will do it sometime tomorrow. I'll prepare a demonstration and it will be posted on the website on how to install the software, and I'll give it a demonstration script on using R, and part of the script will be to regenerate some of the plots and so on that I was using in the class today. So look for that on the website in the next day or so. But in the meantime, it would be great that you install the software once the instructions are up on the website. I hope to put the instructions, the written instructions to install the software on the website tonight. So if you can go through that sometime this week and get back to me with any questions, like if the software is just not working in the computer, then you can try to work through that, because you will need the software for your assignments in the future. Okay, that's pretty much it for today. Thank you.